In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If you're vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
All right, folks, this is Rick Robinson with you. I want to tell you about some friends of mine from a company called Security Enforcement Specialists. When I ran my security agency for 12 years, I worked with one of these partners on a daily basis. He's been involved in this agency now, and with his other partner, they do have over 30 years of experience in the private security industry. If you own a business and you need someone to keep you or your customers or residents safe, then I highly recommend contacting Security Enforcement Specialists today. Give them a call at 405-703-1796. Again, that's 405-703-1796. Again, tell them Rick from K98 Talk sent you. Like I said, if you need the help, they are here for you. So make sure that you go look them up, check them out, and see what they can do. The wrong way. Welcome to the place.
Joe had huge problems with the IRS.
I knew it was coming. I hadn't filed taxes since 1990.
All the IRS letters coming in added up to a nightmare.
To get up to like $68,000, my heart started beating fast. It's like, there's no way, man. I mean, I ain't going to be able to do this.
Then they stopped his paycheck.
So that's when I started making phone calls and found U.S. Tax Shield.
U.S. Tax Shield went to work immediately.
They just took the bull by the horns. What blew my mind is he called the IRS right then and there.
So why is U.S. Tax Shield A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau? Joe knows.
They saved me a ridiculous amount of money.
If you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS or state, choose the company Joe chose, U.S. Tax Shield.
It was the best decision I made. U.S. Tax Shield is the way to go. Life is good. Thank you, Lord.
Call 800-471-3287.
U.S. Tax Shield. Boo-rah. Yes.
800-471-3287. 800-471-3287.
The internet will never be the same. You're listening to K98Talk.com.
Whoa! Good God, y'all!
What is it good for?
From the East Coast to the West Coast. And around the world on the internet. We're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservatives Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Welcome, everybody, and welcome, fellow patriots, and welcome once again to the Conservative Commandos Radio Show. I'm Rick Trader, coming to you live from the studios of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, WNJC 1360, our flagship station in Philadelphia, and around the world on the internet with CPR Worldwide Media, Leading Edge Radio Network, TalkStream Live, The Pun and Press, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, AMFM 24/7, and our newest, the Roar Radio Network. And joining me today, this first part of the Conservative Commandos Radio Show, is George Landreth. George is the CEO and President of Frontiers of Freedom. And George, I'm glad you could stay with us.
And I'm glad to as well. It's always fun.
George, the fun part about doing shows like Frontiers of Freedom, Hour of Action, or the Conservative Commandos radio show is there is always so much to talk about. Last Friday, something happened that people still are talking about, and that is the resignation of John Boehner. George Landreth, were you as surprised as I was?
I was surprised of the announcement that day, but I don't think I was surprised overall, and I'll just tell you why. I have lunch with a group of friends of mine that are kind of like-minded conservatives, and we get together every week or so and have lunch together, and we chat and so forth. And what I found is that a lot of us have noticed that at some point he was likely going to leave, if for no other reason than it just simply wasn't that much fun. So I would not have predicted that on Friday, the day after the Pope's visit. But around the table at lunchtime, a lot of that conversation, was talking about that will be. I think more people thought it might be after this session, meaning that sometime during the holidays. Mm-hmm. And so caught a little off guard by how soon, but not necessarily the ultimate result.
Have you had any discussion with any of your friends that you've had that lunch with since he's resigned?
No, because that lunch has not taken place this week yet, so I will get a chance to do that shortly, but not yet. But I can tell you what folks were saying. There were people there that thought that this might occur literally within 10 days, but I would say most thought it would occur sometime during the holidays once the session was over.
Mm-hmm.
The consensus pick was that.
Well, it's widely reported and speculated that McCarthy from California will be the next Speaker of the House. And what can you tell us about him?
Well, I think... he's considered personable, and he's considered, affable and all, those kinds of things. I think most people kind of like him personally. Mm-hmm. I think most conservatives are pretty wary of him because I think they feel that that his foundation in conservatism is not particularly strong.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the consensus view. In fact, I would say that at the lunch among my friends, that would be probably everyone felt that way.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a single person, of that group that was like, oh no, you're not really being fair. He's a rock rib conservative. I think the view was that he was moderately conservative.
Yeah, I find it interesting to see the media's reaction to Boehner's resignation last Friday morning. I was flipping through the channels, and I happened upon ABC, George Stephanopoulos and his partner were talking about this, and they were saying, oh, this is bad news for the president. It's going to be so much harder for him now to get his agenda passed. And quite frankly, George Landreth, if it does that, I think it's a good thing. If it makes it harder for Barack Obama to get his agenda passed.
If it does that, I'm not convinced it will, and for a variety of reasons, but I'd agree with you. When Barack Obama does not get his way on public policy matters, I think America is generally in a much better position when that happens. What's the big thing that Barack Obama has wanted and achieved that has actually made America a better place? It certainly is not the Iran deal. It's certainly not our general collapse in the eyes of the rest of the world in terms of the prestige and power that America has historically had. It's certainly not our economy. It's certainly not health care. What's better off? You tell me. So obviously, him not getting his way is a good thing.
No,
I'm just not 100% convinced that this change is going to affect that. I think it would. I think it's a complex problem, and I'm not convinced that any of the people that are being most talked about as the likely successor are people that are likely to be in a position to solve that problem.
George, I'm looking at an article
McCarthy's the number one name mentioned, and I don't see McCarthy as leading a much more effective battle against Barack Obama. And it's not because I think he agrees with Barack Obama. I think that if you and I and our listeners sit down with McCarthy in the room, we'd agree on most things. I think that, you know, McCarthy is not a liberal, but McCarthy, I don't believe, is a rock-ribbed conservative. I think he's, you know, he's more malleable. And that may or may not be a good thing. It just depends on whether you think malleability is important or not. But I think, obviously, on some level, you have to be a little bit malleable, because if you're a rock and you get hit on too many times, you just split apart.
Yes.
You can't be. But at the same time, I don't see. There's a variety of reasons why we're not doing that well in some objectives, and I would argue that the House isn't the biggest problem right now. I would argue the Senate is our biggest problem.
I would say it's the leadership in both the House and the Senate that is the biggest problem.
I don't necessarily disagree, but if I were to say what's the bigger problem, I would say it's the Senate and maybe the leadership in the Senate or the Senate as a whole is you know, because. But I agree with you that the House is a better seems more willing to accomplish things than the leadership has been, but I just, when I look at the Senate right now, it seems to me that the House will just go to die in the Senate, mm-hmm. and they used to die in the Senate too. Now the Senate gets some of them through and passes some of them, but I think that I do think that part of the problem the Senate has been, there's been too much of a view that we're going to we're just going to debate things, and we're going to try to work with Harry Reid and so forth, giving him advantages that he never gave us. And I think it might make sense just to basically say, Harry, we're in charge now, and we're going to put the pedal to the metal, and you can either come along for the ride or you can get run over, but mm-hmm. we're not going to mess much with you. Mm-hmm. And that approach has not been taken. And the Senate rules limit some of that, but not entirely, and I feel like there's some procedural things we could have done along the way to really press our advantage that we haven't. That may be true in the House as well, don't get me wrong. Yeah. But the House is, in my view, the second biggest problem, not the biggest problem. The Senate is just, you know, yikes. It's very frustrating, all the things that go to die in the Senate.
George, if you were the kingmaker, who would you put, who would be your choice to be Speaker of the House?
I don't know. That's an interesting question, because I've heard some people say that, Trey Gowdy would be really good. I've heard others. And the problem, I guess, I've heard people say that Kathy McMorris Rogers would be good. I've heard people say that, Peter Roskam would be good. And those are all what I would call dark horses. Mm-hmm. But the problem is, it's not just a function of are they a good conservative, because one could argue, to be perfectly blunt, John Boehner is the most conservative speaker we've had in the last century. I think that's completely, I know people who are
more conservative than Gingrich.
Oh yeah. Uh huh.
Okay.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I know people who actually used to work for Gingrich who say that.
Interesting.
You know, they will concede that point. And I think he's a good person. Whether or not he's been a good leader is, I think, the more interesting question. And so Boehner does not secretly want Obamacare to continue. Boehner does not want, that's not the issue. The question is how hard will people press and how hard will they work and so forth, and are they effective leaders to get people to vote certain ways?
Well, George, we got to take a break, but we can answer that question. Has John Boehner been a good leader? And you are listening to the Conservative Commandos radio show with my good friend George Landreth and yours truly, Rick Trader, coming to you live from the studios of the Conservative Commandos radio network, WNJC 1360 in Philadelphia, and around the world on the internet with CPR Worldwide Media, Leading Edge Radio Network, TalkStream Live, The Pun and Press, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, AMFM 24/7, TheRaw.coms. We have a .net for you, ROARradio.net. Don't go away. George and I will be right back. We're talking about Speaker of the House.
That's my prerogative. They say I'm nasty, but I...
The Conservative Commandos radio show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos radio network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos radio network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos radio network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vide, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with the NRA. This is Bob Vide of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos radio show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos radio show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos radio show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando radio show.
Welcome back to the Conservative Commandos radio show with George Landreth and yours truly, Rick Trader. And if you'd like to hear rebroadcasts of our shows, there's many ways to do that. At 1 p.m. Eastern Time, you can log on to roarradio.net. That's R-O-A-R, which stands for Restoration of American Radio. That's roarradio.net at 1 p.m. And at 9 a.m. in the morning, you can log on to leadingedgeradionetwork.com. You can also hear our show any time of the day from your telephone by calling 832-999-1199. Georgia, before we went to our break, you and I were talking about John Boehner and his resignation. And you brought up what kind of a leader John Boehner was.
Well, I think... getting back to the question of kind of leadership, I don't think that if we sat down in a room that he would disagree with on the substance of any of the issues that matter. But I think he was more of a manager than a leader. And so his goal was to manage things. A leader has a different perspective. I think his goal is we want to get to this location. I'm going to find a way to make that happen. I'm going to marshal my resources. If I have to, I'm going to build my resources. I'm going to find a way to get it done. Almost being entrepreneurial. And that's, I think, the difficulty, because, say Congressman X from town Y in state Z, he may have a perfectly good voting record. He may have an awesome voting record. He may speak passionately about the issues. But the question is when he has the authority, is he a manager? Is he more of a consensus guy? Is he more of a you know, an entrepreneurial leader. I would argue that your most effective leaders have a little bit of everything in them. They know when to manage, and they manage when that's appropriate. But they also, but sometimes they know now is the time to essentially build that consensus, not just let it happen, but to make it happen. And I don't know if I know who that person is, because one of the problems is we end up picking a speaker, and then we find out if they're ready for the job or not. We don't have a junior speaker league or a junior, you know, we just don't.
Well, isn't that what the House...
majority leader is that.
Okay, right now the House, the majority leader is Kevin McCarthy. Isn't that the proving ground?
I think it's supposed to be, but I think the majority leader, in many respects, fills a different function. Mm-hmm. And so as a result, it's hard for that person. The speaker is the speaker, and the speaker is, you know, that's a big deal. Everything below the speaker is a much less big deal, and I don't mean to say it's unimportant. I'm just saying it's not the same pressure, so we don't really know. It's kind of like the difference between the first-string quarterback and the second-string quarterback. You know, there's a big drop-off there. The first-string quarterback you see every week. You see him play. And the second-string quarterback you only see sometimes, and you may not know. You may see him in practice a few times, but in practice you're wearing a yellow jersey. Nobody can hit you, so the pressure is different. So maybe... you know, maybe the second-string quarterback performs pretty well in practice, but you get him a game twice, and he gets hit a couple times, and all of a sudden he's throwing interceptions. You know, that's what I guess I'm getting at, is we don't have a real live testing ground. We have kind of what I would call an ersatz method of doing that. It gives us some approximations, and it gives us some guesses. But I would say, based on what I've seen, Kevin McCarthy is less conservative than Boehner, and I would say that he's probably much more, he's gonna be a consensus guy.
He's a big
guy. That the problem, and there's nothing wrong with a consensus. That's great, but sometimes leaders. I mean, in the United States in 1776, there was no consensus for liberty.
Right.
There simply was not. And so a group of we now call the Founding Fathers got together and led America to to this consensus. And then America fought for its independence and became a free nation, and everyone else knows the rest of the history.
Right.
But the point is, if they had been managers, if they had just been like, well, we'll let what happens going to happen, and we'll help guide what's happening, and we'll, you know, there's... we need someone I think who's going to help direct what's going to happen. And that's the question I'm not 100% sure on as to what we've got there. But I've not seen anything in Mr. McCarthy that makes me think that. And I'm not trying to call him names. I'm not saying he's a turncoat. He's a traitor. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I think he probably agree. I mean, he's not as conservative as I am. He's not as conservative as you are. But he's going to agree with us on virtually every issue. He doesn't like Obamacare. You know, he doesn't like the out-of-control spending right now. He doesn't like, you know, all the crazy stuff Barack Obama's doing. I mean, you know, that's not the issue. The issue isn't does he not like it. The issue is, does he have a sense of how entrepreneurial he should be in fighting those things? And what sort of leadership will he exert to create the entrepreneurial environment which those things will succeed?
George, there was a very interesting article on yesterday's Daily Signal, written by Kate Scanlon, who has been a guest here on Conservative Commando's radio show. Six times John Boehner clashed with conservatives. And the six times were, and I won't go into to the explanation, we don't have enough time to do that, but basically, Boehner clashed with conservatives over Planned Parenthood, immigration, government spending, the Export-Import Bank, power of the purse, and Obamacare.
But what's important to understand is I think on substantively, he agreed with the conservatives on every issue. Where he disagreed was on the tactics to accomplish that, and that's what I'm getting at. In other words, it can't just be that we look at the next speaker and say, oh, I like that guy because he agrees with me. Mm-hmm. Because the truth of the matter is, I think Boehner agreed with us, but he wasn't the entrepreneurial leader that said, we have to head in this direction to make this happen. Mm-hmm. And so you're right. Those were areas of disagreement. but they were more on the tactics of, we can't win, so we won't fight. Mm-hmm. And Senator Wallop used to say, sometimes it is worth to have the fight, even if it going into the fight, you're sure you're going to lose it. And the reason is it educates the public. I'll give you an example on Planned Parenthood. The public will not fully, you and I may be aware of all that. Some people that are really aware, you know, listeners here will know about that. But the average American is not necessarily tuned into that. They don't know. If Congress never holds a vote, never holds a debate, never works on this issue, then they will not become educated. And then when it comes time to hold an election and you tell people you need to elect somebody who's going to not put up with this crazy stuff and is going to be more sensible, they're going to go, what are you talking about? So you have to have the vote even when you think you might lose the vote, because that helps you prepare in the future to have changed votes, different outcomes.
Oh, well, that's a great point, George. Hey, George, we got to wrap up in about a minute. I want to thank you for sitting in today, not just with Frontiers of Freedom Hour of Action, but this first part of the Conservative Commandos radio show. We're going to take a break. After the break, we're going to play an interview that we did with former Congressman Steve Stockman yesterday about John Boehner and also his dealings with Kevin McCarthy when McCarthy was the House Whip. But George, please tell our audience where they could follow you and follow the work of Frontiers of Freedom.
Absolutely. Well, Frontiers of Freedom is found at www.ff.org. You can follow me at Twitter at George Landreth. George, the normal spelling, and Landreth is L-A-N-D-R-I-T-H. And as always, they can tune in on Tuesdays at 2, and of course they must stick around and continue listening to Conservative Commandos. Lots of great information to help arm every conservative with what they need to know.
That's right, George. That's why we're here. By the way, George, tomorrow is a kind of a significant date in the history of Conservative Commandos. 5 years tomorrow, we took to the air. So,
awesome.
And George Landreth, I want to thank you again so much for helping out today. Take care, my friend. God bless, and we'll talk to you next week.
Always my pleasure. Thanks.
The Conservative Commandos radio show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos radio network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos radio network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today, the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vyden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the Internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios. WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos radio show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos radio show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos radio show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Kevin, we do have our first guest with us, and the honor of the introduction is yours.
Hey, thank you very much. I believe he's calling from a great distance, so I will speak up. Steve Stockman served in the U.S. House of Representatives representing the 36th District of Texas with the vision of limited government, strong support for American families, and a robust national defense. While in Congress, Steve Stockman sat on the House Foreign Affairs Committee and played an active role in uncovering the truth about the attack on the U.S. consulate in Benghazi. And with that, Congressman Stockman, welcome back to the Conservative Commandos radio show.
Well, thank you so much. I was listening to your discussion a little bit on the global warming back a long time ago. I really think it's because the bison were using antifreeze and smoking cigarettes. Guys
what
are so
combination.
Insensitive.
What a combination.
And I thought it was over hunting. Okay, it was this darn tobacco that did them in.
It's funny. I don't know if you saw the predictions. I mean, these guys, they're so funny that, you know, first they have global cooling, then global warming. They're going, okay, we give up. It's climate change. can't. And it happens four times a year.
Well, it's about time they do something about that, okay? Congressman, it's so good to have you back on the show. Well, there's big news out of Washington. Now, I know you're not firmly entrenched in Washington these days. You are a free man, and you're speaking freely with a clear conscience.
But, that's right.
But what do you make of the resignation of Speaker of the House, John Boehner?
Well, I tell you, we're a hero in all this. And by the way, they're going to make it. I just read an article, it's called On the Hill, where they actually, this shows you how fake all the news is. They said that the conservative group, the Freedom Caucus, actually was in negotiation with Boehner's office in August. So it's kind of a little bit of deception there that it was spontaneous. And the person who gets the most credit is Congressman Mark Meadows, who is a great conservative and just a really godly man, too. And if you ever, I don't know if you have him on your show, but you should pull him on your show. He's just a really great guy, and I served with him on the Foreign Affairs Committee. But he issued a thing to vacate the chair, which can be, without getting too much technical stuff, it could be a privileged motion, meaning they have to take it up. Boehner can't bury it, can't do this. And he was pretty smart. He just laid it on the table and said, this is what we're going to do if you don't, you know, we don't get some changes. And that was enough, because it would be very embarrassing for someone that's in the speaker to lose the chair, and then thereby you leave office. And most of the time when that technique is used, usually the person in charge or the speaker leaves within a year. So that's exactly what happened. Mark won't take credit for it. He's very modest. Oh, no, no, no. But in truth, that's what happened. I'm sure what Boehner did over the what they call a recess break was to contact people to find out, or his people, the lieutenants, and found out he didn't have the support. So, you know, he did what he had to do.
And also by...
But the problem...
Steve, also by making that motion just prior to the August recess, it allowed a lot of conversations to take place back home for a lot of Republican congressmen who were getting, you know, peppered with these questions. And they had to understand where they stood in relation to their own constituents in this matter.
Yeah, the timing, Mark's timing and his execution was actually pretty flawless. I mean, the guy with a great deal of principle, so it's not that, you know, I'm more bombastic and, you know, going after people. I'm pretty aggressive. Where Mark is considered to be, you know, I'm the bomb thrower. He's really considered to be a more, quote, thoughtful guy. Because I guess he talks slower. I don't know. but he really is one of the best congressmen on the Hill. He really is. Unfortunately, he's not running, and neither are many conservatives that should be running. Louis Gohmert, my good friend, is not running. Some other people aren't running. And the problem is, from what I understand, in August, they made an agreement with a guy who's just like Boehner, without the crying, and probably actually a little bit more vindictive than Boehner. And that really concerns me. I just think McCarthy is going to be a... By the way, they're both bar owners, so that says something about where our Congress is.
What are the dynamics behind the scene to build support for being the Speaker of the House? Is it kind of like being selected as the precinct captain, but on a grander scale?
No, it's a little bit more. Yes, no. I mean, the situation is that you build and people's loyalty to appointments of committee chairmanship. Now, that's something that I never really. I don't know, if someone says, you know, you really want to have a Corvette, but if you don't really want a Corvette, it's not, you know, that much of a motivating factor. And for me, it was never really that much of a motivator. They said, you'll never make chairman. I go, like, well, I wasn't planning on it. Because I'd rather do the right thing than worry about a position. Well, many of those guys in those positions, that is their whole career, their whole who they are, the power. You know, chairmanships have very strong power. And so they're responsible for all the votes on their committee. So you have a chairman, and you tell your lieutenants, chairman, hey, I want this done, blah, blah, blah. And they, in turn, get all the people in line to support, you know, you. And so there's a lot of pledges made to people that have a lot of sway. So that's how it works. It's very similar to the way the Casa Nostras and others divide things up, you know.
Yeah, pretty much the way things have worked for 5,000 years, I guess. But so in the musical chairs, it begins by by emptying the Speaker of the House's chair. That sets up all this locomotion, and people are now thinking, I can be the next chair of that committee if I sign up to this branch of the family, so to speak.
Yeah, and they want to go with the guy that's winning. So it's self-fulfilling, unfortunately. They say, well, McCarthy's going to win, so I'm going to cut a deal with it. It's really pretty disappointing. You know, they always say it looks like the way you make sausage, but it is kind of disappointing the way people do it. And then really the 40 principal people in the Freedom Caucus are really trying to marginalize them. In Washington Post, everybody's going to be ridiculing them. But that's one thing, if your listeners can get the list, and I'm sure you can by Googling it, but you really need to write or call and give them a word of encouragement, because I tell you, it gets pretty lonely up there when you have the whole national press and people coming out, standing outside your door attacking you. It's not something that's just done like once. It's just over and over and over and over again. In fact, when I was first in office, we actually had people staked out in front of my apartment. So it was... It's not pleasant, so that's why it's always good for your listeners to call and or drop a note and say, we appreciate you doing, keep up the good work, because we don't hear enough from our side, to be honest with you.
Yeah, it's understood, and I don't know how this is going to play out with the rank and file, with the grassroots if they look back in 6 months and find out that Kevin McCarthy is just a West Coast version of John Boehner. That's going to be smack dab in the middle of the final 3 months of three, 4 months of a presidential campaign, and that could absolutely blow up. I mean, the grassroots want to see a battle line drawn, and they don't expect to win, but they do expect to see someone form a battle line and fight.
Well, I mean, that's what's so stupid about over in the Senate. McConnell goes, well, he's going to veto it. Well, you let him veto the bill, then run on it. I mean, it's just a ridiculous premise. Well, he's going to veto it. Could you imagine a football team going, Notre Dame going, well, we're not going to go out on the field because our opponents are going to kick our butt, so we're going to stay back. No, we're not going to play the game because we're going to lose. They need to put that stuff on there and get Obama vetoing and putting Democrats. This, and I think it's important. Even if Obama vetoes it, you now have senators that are going to vote for or against Planned Parenthood funding. I mean, that's important to get those people on record for them to be defeated. It's mind-boggling the rationale they use. Well, we don't want to be fighters. We want to all get along. Well, you know, if you're going to burn, you know, the Democrats say we're going to burn down D.C. and the Republicans say now we're going to do it in sections, you still achieve the same thing. I mean,
well, speaking of the Freedom Caucus, I want to point some of our listeners to Andy Harris of Maryland. He's a member of the caucus. Scott Garrett of New Jersey, speak with him. Scott Perry of Pennsylvania, that might be within our footprint.
Scott, you must have him on your show, I'm sure, frequently. He is a tremendous guy.
And as former Congressman Steve Stockman says, call them, give them encouragement, give them some good heart, because the folks back home are not interested in how smoothly Washington is running. They're scared to death about how poorly their lives are unfolding. And I've used this example on the show before. I mean, there's a fellow by the name, he was half American, so we'll give him half credit, by the name of Winston Churchill, who
he's going to say Obama.
No, I wouldn't. Not on. You've got the wrong calling station here, my friend. but Winston Churchill, now this is important, is best remembered for his defiance in the face of defeat at the worst possible time, because it was his defiance that rallied the public for the final victory. And if you have leaders who say, hey, they've got 5,000 tanks and we've got 50, they've got 3 million troops and we can only muster up 300,000 who don't have their guns anymore because they left them on the beach back at Dunkirk, let's go negotiate a settlement. You're not going to win the battle, and we have to win the battle for the sake of our republic.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And the American way is what Churchill spoke to is to fight against all odds. But now we capitulate against all odds. I mean, we throw the towel in before the first bell's rung. It's just amazing. And McConnell's been in office for a long time, should know that the importance of getting people on record. I almost think he intentionally doesn't vote in order to do favors to these people. Yeah, you know, oh, he's a nice guy. I don't want to put him in the position of voting on us. That's the wrong attitude to take. I remember when I first defeated a congressman back in the 90s, and he was there 42 years. I had Republicans coming up to me, oh, you know, we really liked his wife, and we can't believe you defeated him. I mean, I was like, you got to be kidding me. I was so shocked. Of course, other people thank me, but it's still odd behavior.
Now, you're supposed to express the will of your constituents. I mean, if you won't be their voice, and that voice, you know, the message can change every couple years, okay, because our interests change. But if you won't be their voice, who in the world could be their voice? I mean, it really is a solemn responsibility.
The mechanism, you're absolutely right. The mechanism is supposed to be that, but there are, as I spoke to, people that see themselves as, you know, this is their livelihood, this is who they are, and the more power they get, the more, I mean, some of you guys start believing their own press releases. And that's a very dangerous situation. You know, you're there to serve the people, not the other way around. And yet there's a lot of guys that believe that and act that way. And it's often after a while you do get spoiled. I mean, I had almost 40 people working for me, and all of them catering to you and telling you how great you are.
Yeah, but in your case, you deserved it, Steve. You knew that.
What's that?
Hey,
I didn't believe it.
Steve, could you stay with us through a short break? I really would like to continue this conversation.
Yeah, I can, but as I said, I'm 8,000 miles away. I hope you can hear me. Sometimes they say there's clicking noise when I call from overseas.
Well, that's the NSA, and they're working another show right now. I'm getting the fellow who pays the bill says, don't worry about the commercial. Okay, well, Kevin Wade, commercial sponsors, it wasn't Kevin Wade. Okay, so we're going to stay with you. So we're going to have Kevin McCartney.
No, you can do a quick commercial. I'll hang. I don't want to lose. I mean, this is free market. That's no problem. I'll just send the bill to him. No, I'm kidding. Hey, real quick, how close are you to Scott's district, by the way?
Scott Garrett? Scott Garrett is in North Jersey. I would say we're about 100 miles.
Well, you ought to really thank him, because a lot of times he's very, I don't know how well, I'm sure you know him well, but he is very principled. And I might add, he's not braggadocious or anything. He's relatively calm, but man, every time I see him do anything, he's really good.
Well, Congressman Stockman, that's the only criticism that I've ever heard about Scott Garrett, is some people think he needs to be a little bit more out there, a little bit more braggadocious, but that's just not him.
No, he's not exactly Donald Trump, is he?
No, he isn't. No, he isn't.
He's very, actually, and nothing to, I think one of the reasons he's quiet, he's a very thoughtful guy. You know, you ask him a question, you can tell. He's actually listening to the debate. He reads a lot. I don't know this for sure, but it appears to read everything he votes on. He's just a real amazing guy in terms of a congressman, and he's from New Jersey.
I know. Only true conservative congressman that we have in the state of New Jersey. We have other Republicans, but they're rhino Republicans like Lobiondo, MacArthur, Leonard Lance, you know, people that call themselves Republicans, but I would say they have a little R behind their name.
Well, for your listeners, I can testify that in private, he is just as thoughtful and considerate and conservative as he is in his public. So if you guys can encourage him, even when, like, his birthday comes around, everybody call him, wish him happy birthday, just because he gets beat up a lot, and he's very stoic. He will not really complain to anybody, and yet he takes some very good positions.
Well, the good news is he's in a pretty safe district up there. That is one of the few really safe Republican districts in the state.
Well, I'm sure they packed it so they could get more Democrats elected.
Of course, surrounded by 19 Democrat districts.
Yeah. Yeah,
it was. Yeah.
Congressman, you know what was very interesting, and I'll pass this on to you. I don't know if you saw this or not, but the last Friday morning when it was announced that Boehner was retiring, I just happened to be watching ABC, and George Stephanopoulos was on there with his partner there, and she was nearly crying. She was nearly crying by saying, oh, this is going to make it so much harder for Barack Obama. And I was slightly encouraged by that, but now I'm not as encouraged as I was Friday morning, the more and more I find out about Kevin McCarthy.
Tell you what, McCarthy, one time, they do what's called, he was a whip when I got there, and they do a whip check, which means they're asking you, how are you voting on XYZ, so they know, you know, the direction the ship's going, which I don't have a problem with that. And one time I changed my mind, and he just blew up at me and started screaming at me. I'm like, you know what? I said, I got elected here to do the right, to do the right thing. And I said, I read more of the bill, and I don't like it. You can't do that. You can't tell me one thing and do another. So that day forward.
Oh, you mean he got mad at you because you read the bill?
Yeah, well, that day forward, his staff would ask me how am I voting on the bill. I said, I don't know yet. I never answered again. I said, well, you know, if I'm going to get in trouble for telling you. I mean, 9 out of 10 times I told him what I was going to do, but that one time for him to get upset over me changing was just over the top. And he really blew up. So I don't know. I think it's going to be much worse on the conservatives, and I'm stunned that they would negotiate with him in August not to take them out. It was just unbelievable. I don't know. So we're going to see. I think I'm right on this one, though, unfortunately.
Hmm. Congressman, there was an article that I received today from Kate Scanlon. She writes for the Daily Signal. And she said, 6 times John Boehner clashed with conservatives. I'd like to give you this list real quick. And if you could, tell me what you think might change with a Speaker McCarthy. 1, Planned Parenthood. 2, immigration. 3, government spending. 4, the Export-Import Bank. 5, the power of the purse. 6, Obamacare. Can you see any of those things changing with the Speaker McCarthy?
Yeah, you're going to get immigration passed.
Oh.
I don't know if you realize this. He's from California, and that's a very big issue there. And it's really drives me nuts. And so we're going to have a pathway to citizenship. We have a pathway. It's pretty well worn down. You can follow the pathway of millions of others. So I don't know why they keep saying there's got to be a pathway to citizenship. No, it's just not the case. We have pathway, but he's pro-immigration for illegal immigrants to come in. Which, ironically, if we did this actually in our office. We took the stats of the elections in California where the majority of the illegal immigrants became legal after Ronald Reagan in 84, and it's when we lost California. California used to be a Republican state. Mm. There's a direct correlation to the percentage of new immigrants and Republicans losing. And even Facebook founder, who's, by the way, a radical leftist, who was running the group Conservatives for Immigration Reform, which is really weird. It's kind of like, Nazis for Jews or something. It was bizarre. Mm-hmm. And he even admitted, he said, yeah, this, his primary focus is actually voters, not any other kind of thing. I mean, he's pretty blunt. His sister was on the Obama campaign. So, and ran his Facebook, by the way, and the majority of Romney's Facebook ads are run by Obama. So you had some pretty nefarious stuff going on. And he's really a dislikable gentleman in terms of his business habits, as you saw from the movie, and now in terms of his political habits, even his construction of his home. He blocked the streets for months while he spent millions and millions of dollars constructing his home and chasing off neighbors. He just is a very selfish person, and having this immigration policy, it will lose Texas to the Democrats if it passes. And you will never, ever get a Republican elected to office at the national level, like president, ever again.
And you know who really, really, really resents some fast track to citizenship or quasi-citizenship for illegals? It's the millions
probably
of people.
Probably the unions should.
No. Well, a lot of the unions, but millions of people who took the 10, 15 years to do it the right way.
Oh, right.
Who waited and waited and filled out the forms and worried that the paperwork was in order and worried that it would be renewed and could they did it the right way. They're extraordinarily proud of a life achievement to become a U.S. citizen. It means something to them. And Republicans have no message to reach
process?
Those people.
Yeah, listen, Rick, my friend who followed that process, he said he feels like he's going to a movie and a bunch of people just cut in line in front of him.
Yep. And why the Republican Party and the conservative movement can't reach those people is beyond me. I mean, it's absolutely beyond me.
They should do the commercial with Barbara Jordan, who's an idol to the left. She's a Texas black congresswoman. One of the
I know. She's special. She's a special
she
one.
She ripped illegal immigration. Ripped it. The documents she produced is some of the best information on immigration. And it all stems back to Ted Kennedy's 1965 immigration bill, which has really been disastrous for American culture.
And jobs in the African-American community as well.
Yeah.
There are jobs that for decades, generations, were just the property of some prominent African-American families in certain cities, and they have been undercut by newly formed groups where half the work crew is legal, the other half aren't, and they underbid everyone, and they drive that established business out of business. And it plays out again and again and again across big cities in America.
Do you know who wrote the policy paper for Rice Priestess? It's unbelievable. It is none other than Ari Fletcher, who's, I think that's his proper name. He's now a professor at UCLA, you know, the bastion of conservatism. He's never run for office. He's never won an office. His primary thing was that of a press spokesman. And he comes up with this paper, and then the Republicans adopt it. It's saying, you know, if we don't allow this rampant immigration, we're going to lose their votes. Trust me, those people coming across the southern border are not libertarian Republicans. Or it's just a fallacy. And you think that we did it once, and Reagan did it, and they turned around and two-thirds of them vote against Reagan and Reagan's, you know, successors or whatever. And somehow this is going to overnight be magically turn these guys into, you know, conservatives. It's an absolute fallacy.
Yep, and it touches on a person's sense of identity as an American citizen. Whether people in Washington understand it or not, there are many people, many of us, consider the fact that we're an American citizen to be one of the most proud identifiers of our entire existence in life, that we are an American citizen, either by the good fortune of birth or by that long multi-year journey of naturalization. So very, very proud. And to see people in Washington just kind of demean it and cheapen it and dilute it,
Yep. It's
so offensive at a gut level. And people in Washington don't understand why they are despised. And I mean, I'm not throwing that word out loosely. They're, in fact, despised by people who love their country.
Yeah, and the thing is, you hear people that do immigrate here that cut the frontal lines, they want to turn it into the culture they left because it was bad. That makes no sense. If you're fleeing your culture you consider bad, why then would you want to impose it on us? And there was in Houston, there was a United States versus Mexico game, and the citizens of Houston were actually attacking other citizens, primarily non-Mexicans, and they were rooting for the team, which Mexico team, so they don't have any kind of allegiance or anything. Most of the immigrants that follow the process, they're deeply, not all, but many of them are very deeply patriotic and love this country because they worked so hard getting it and they appreciate it more. The ones that cut in front of the line, as in all cases, don't appreciate it.
Yeah, and there's a common experience of going through the melting pot brings, whether you're an immigrant from Czechoslovakia, the old Czech Republic, or South Korea, and that's something along the lines of you went to the supermarket for the first time, and is it true that if you go six more times you get a free turkey? That just amazes people, that exposure to free enterprise and the great freedoms we have, and it's something that they're part of their experience, is part of their becoming an American. They're proud of it. They tell stories about it. They joke about it. It's part of their life. And to see that you can jump in line, okay, because you've got sympathetic friends who help you cross the border, is frankly, I don't know if we use this word anymore. It's anti-American. It's un-American. Steve Stockman, God bless you for coming with us. Thank you for all your good service in Washington. And you're always welcome on the Conservative Commandos radio show.
Well, you guys are great. Keep up the fight. We have so much disinformation out there, and you guys are a ray of hope of countering that. And really just appreciate you guys. And in these troubled times, I mean, hearing you guys are just urgent. So I really appreciate you, too.
Thanks, Congressman. It's always a pleasure.
All right. Take care. Bye-bye.
We're coming to you live from the Conservative Commandos Radio Network Studios, WNJC 1360 AM, our flagship station in Philadelphia and around the world on the Internet with CPR Worldwide Media, a leading-edge radio network, TalkStream Live, The Pundit Press, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, and AM/FM 24/7. They all end in .com. And now you can listen to our show at any time from our website, ccrsnetwork.com and ccrshow.com. You stay with us. We'll be back in 3 short minutes.
Paul Deltz playing the music on the Your Music Matters Morning Show. He is also an experienced mortgage loan officer working for U.S. Mortgage Corporation and assists homeowners navigate the reverse mortgage process. If you are finding yourself asking questions whether or not you set aside enough for retirement, Paul can sit down with you, your family, and your financial advisor and discuss how a reverse mortgage may be a valuable resource for your retirement plan. You will be responsible for paying your taxes and insurance, and the reverse mortgage can help with this and other expenses such as home health care or other untimely bills. Put Paul's 20-plus years of experience to work for you, as choosing the right option for your situation can be critical. Call Paul at U.S. Mortgage Corporation at 877-213-9977. That's 877-213-9977. Or go to seniormatters.info for more information. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is a licensed mortgage banker in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and Delaware, and an equal housing lender. NMLS number 3901. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is located at 201 Old Country Road, Suite 140, Melville, New York, 11747. This advertisement applies to first lien mortgages. Paul E. Dilks, NMLS, is 485-901.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Biden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
What does it take to be the leader in production systems technology? To be the one company that solves production problems at any plant, for any product, and with any technology? It takes a 30-year record of success. It takes total mastery of complex technologies with a history of delivering success every time, without fail. Only one company can claim that high ground in manufacturing line optimization, data automation, and systems integration, and that's Philadelphia Control Systems. In factories worldwide, Philadelphia Control Systems programs, software, and engineering solutions deliver optimal performance and output flow with a record that can't be matched. Any plant, any product, any technology. Philadelphia Control Systems, the leader in production automation since 1982. 800-335-9811. PCS for automation.com. That's PCS, the number 4, automation.com.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We're establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired as I am about the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. on WNJC Radio 1360 a.m. or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our websites, ConservativeCommandosRadioNetwork.com and CCRN.com for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where even more newsmakers go to be heard.
This is the Frontiers of Freedom, Hour of Action. I'm George Landreth, and of course, my co-host Rick Trader. We are coming to you live. He's coming to you from the studios in Philadelphia in WNJC, that's 1360 AM on the radio dial there. And I'm coming to you live from the Washington, D.C. area, and of course, we're using the Internet as well, so you don't have to be in Philadelphia to listen. But I guess if you just heard me say that, you're not in Philadelphia, you already knew that. But anyhow, we hope that, I guess, people pick up in the podcast and things like that. So we just have to make sure that everyone knows you can hear us any place as long as you've got a connection with the Internet. Well, we have lots of interesting things to go on, but before we jump into that, I just want to remind folks they can always check out our website at www.ff.org. FF.org, Frontiers of Freedom, is what that's about. And many things we talk about, you'll find supplemental and additional information on our website, and you'll find additional things there as well. But, you know, I was thinking this week that you had the passing of Yogi Berra. And whether you're a Yankees fan or not, it seems to me you have to be a fan of Yogi Berra. He said the most, you know, amazingly wonderful things. And there's a part of me that says he just stumbled upon some of this stuff. But in some cases, there's no way. There had to be at least some glimmer of genius in him at moments because of some of the things he said. Like when you come to a fork on the road, take it. Or, a nickel ain't worth a dime anymore. Stuff like that. You know, or it ain't over till it's over. The things that, in many cases, become in our lexicon. But anyhow, so I thought in honor of him, one, we should mention him. And two, I think, you know, Rick, you and I should try to use some of his wisdom throughout the show to the extent it's appropriate and works as well and naturally. But it just seems to me we ought to, you know, have a small dedication to him in that way, if that makes any sense.
Indeed, George, and Yogi Berra was a tremendous man, and not just in baseball. Remember the New York Yankees, 10 World Series wins, Hall of Fame. There was one year, George, as a catcher, he did not commit a single error. But I think the greatest thing about Yogi Berra was the fact that he was part of the D-Day invasion, that he was he was a gunner on one of the landing boats.
Yep.
A tremendous guy.
Yeah. No, great American. So, like I said, I've got a brother who's a Boston Red Sox fan and doesn't have a lot of use for the Yankees. I bet you he has a soft spot in his heart for a great American like Yogi Berra. At any rate, so with that, let's jump into the rest of our stories. But I thought the good news is, I mean, I am always grateful when I wake up in the morning and I'm on this side of the sod as opposed to the other side of the sod. And given the fact that the planet is still here, news, because it wasn't 500 days ago that the French minister, the foreign minister, while meeting with John Kerry and holding a joint press conference, warned of climate chaos and said that there's only 500 days to take action and that after that it would just be, you know, doomsday and so forth. So I thought to myself, you know, when the 500 days passed, whew, I am so glad I am still here. And, you know, I don't know about you, but to me that's just awesome news because when the French foreign minister tells me that climate chaos is only 500 days away, I take notice.
You would think everyone would, George. But, you know, this Earth has been around for upwards of 3 billion years now, and very little has changed over the last 500 days, except I think Barack Obama has gotten more stupid, actually. So has John Kerry, you know, with the Iranian deal, and we've talked about that. But it is a good day. Any day you wake up, you open a newspaper, you read the obituaries, and yours isn't there, that's a win day.
That is, it is. Well, one of the things I thought was funny was in his comments, the comments I referred to, I'll quote from them. He starts off by talking just the kind of obligatory, you know, he's glad that John's there, referring to John Kerry and how they talk on the phone all the time, lots of important things, and then he lists them. Iran, because of negotiations resuming today, you know, at that time, and then he says, you know, the question of Syria, That seems obvious to me. And then, of course, he says that Ukraine was an issue as well. He just lists those off very quickly. And then the rest of his statement is about climate change, because, of course, that's the really important, pressing matter that is that a foreign minister in Europe or a secretary of state in the United States should be worried about. So this is what he says. And very important issues, issues of climate change, climate chaos. And we have, as I said, we have 500 days to avoid climate chaos. And I know that President Obama and John Kerry himself are committed on this subject, and I am sure that with them and with lots of other friends, we will be able to reach success on this very important matter. Well, the good news is that they didn't actually do anything, and the 500 days came and went, and yay! So I'm just, you know, it's just awesome. So to me, this is where I can pop in with my first Yogi Berra-ism, which is, this is like deja vu all over again. Because they have been, the left, saying this silly stuff and predicting environmental chaos and disaster since I was a child. I mean, in the 60s and 70s, they used to, I remember in a government class, I'm sitting in my high school class, in the government class, before class began, we would have, in the early few minutes of class, he wouldn't start the lecture because he wanted us to pick up the news magazines he had on a table and kind of read some articles. And so I can distinctly remember, it would have been in the late 1970s, picking up either a Newsweek or a Time or a U.S. News and World Report, one of those. And the cover story was about the coming glaciation. The ice age was coming. We were going to all freeze to death, and there's going to be mass starvation because we wouldn't be able to grow crops because the planet would be so cold and so covered with ice that the end was coming. Mm. And so, of course, it wasn't but a few years later that, of course, then they changed their story, and that was global warming. And then, of course, the warming stopped about 16 years ago, 18 years ago, somewhere in that range. It's tapered off now, and we're in a plateau, no more warming, so now it's climate change. And so every time we get a warm day or a hot day or a rainy day, it's climate change, you know, as if the climate never did that before. Because when I was a very young lad, of course, the weather was just always the same. It never... You know, I mean, when it rained all the time. When it was sunny, it was sunny all the time. We never had unusually hot days or unusually cold days when I was a boy. Did they when you were a boy?
Well, you know, George, I think the times have changed. When I was a kid, we never had air conditioning. It was just a hot day. And you dealt with it the best way you could. You went swimming. You sat inside in front of a fan. You dealt with it in different ways than you do with the temperature today. But I can remember those days in the 1970s, George. In fact, I think it was on the cover of Time magazine how we were starting into a new ice age and how climate is changing. And, George, I can believe in climate change. I really do, and let me tell you why. And you and I have talked about this before. Maybe some of our other listeners, maybe some of our listeners are joining us from the first time, haven't heard this. But in the last 100,000 years, there have been four major ice ages. The last one was only 12,000 years ago. And 12,000 years ago, there was an ice sheet that covered North America, and that ice sheet was 2 miles thick. Now, today, we don't have that ice sheet in North America the way we did back then. But I bet you if you go back...
What would have caused all that 2 mile thick sheet of ice to melt?
Well, I guess it was what they were driving and how they were heating their homes back then, George.
Yeah.
You know, how they were...
yuppies and SUVs. I knew it.
So, George, my prediction is if these same climate change people come back in 12,000 years, there'll be another ice sheet covering North America, and they'll say, see, we told you so.
Exactly. Well, you're right. The point, I guess, ultimately, is climate does change. We are mistaken to assume that just because in a given decade, the weather seems fairly static. I don't mean on any given day, because, of course, there's seasons, and the winter's colder than summer, and summer's warmer than winter.
Right.
But I mean, you know, normally the variation, we can compare last summer to this summer, and we can compare next summer to the one after that, and they'll be pretty comparable. They will not be massive differences normally. But over centuries, there are changes, and it's slow, but there are changes. And those occurred long before industrialization. Those occurred long before yuppies started driving SUVs. So I always find this funny because that's the take here. But yet there's always these, you know, oh my goodness, the world's going to end tomorrow, these Chicken Little, the sky is falling sorts of predictions. In 1971, Stanford University professor Paul Ehrlich, he's perhaps best known for a book he wrote called The Population Bomb. He predicted all kinds of cataclysmic things. He talked about how England would cease to exist by the year 2000. It would simply be a small group of impoverished islands inhabited, you know, by essentially a small group of hungry people that would be starving to death and so forth. And, of course, that hasn't happened. And that was, of course, at that time, that was because of climate cooling, not warming. And then they've changed. You know, I'll jump ahead. You go to 2005, the UN warned of imminent sea level rises, increased hurricanes. Of course, we've had a lull in hurricanes in the last decade, not an increase. But, you know, there was going to be this, you know, essentially they refer to this desertification, meaning the more the world would become like a desert. And that this would be because of man-made global warming. I mean, I believe the climate changes, and I believe it does that naturally without our input. We may have some very modest, you know, a hundredth of a degree impact on what the temperature is, but I don't think we drive it. I don't think there's any evidence of that. When you look at the evidence is the Earth does what it does, and we're along for the ride. And if it gets colder, we'll have to put on a coat. And if it gets warmer, we'll have to turn up the fan. But we're not going to actually determine what those are. But anyhow, these studies claim that all these islands would become underwater, that we're going to have more than... But they said by 2010, there would be 50 million climate refugees. So 5 years ago, there were supposed to be 50 million climate refugees. These are people that were basically fleeing from regions of the globe that had become... Not from ISIS. They weren't saying ISIS refugees. Climate refugees that the... they'd be coming because of, you know, massive flooding, their land would be underwater, or it would have turned to a desert, and so therefore they had to leave. Mm-hmm. Of course, this hasn't happened. So to me, this is the... And of course, Al Gore is one of the famous, you know, kooks on these issues. He's told us that there would be no more ice on the poles as early, even as recently as, 6 years ago he was claiming this. And of course, we now know that the ice is thicker on both poles than it has been in a long time, and there's plenty of, you know, ice on the Earth. But this is the, you know, the president goes up to Alaska a couple weeks ago and talks about how, look at the receding glacier. Well, that glacier actually started receding, they said, back in, like, 1790 or something. It was
right.
It didn't start receding in 1960. But that's how they always get to this hysteria. So like I said, all of our listeners should be grateful. They woke up this morning. The sun did rise. You know, they were still alive, and the things still work. Will miracles never cease?
It's a great day, George.
Next time someone says, "Hey, tomorrow the world's going to end," Chicken Little, just roll your eyes and move along.
It is indeed a great day, George.
It is. Well, with that, we've probably got to take a break, but I do think, though, that this does perhaps bear out another one of Yogi Berra's statements, which is, the future ain't what it used to be. They were wrong in predicting the future, and they could probably borrow from Yogi Berra and say that that's the reason, because it ain't what it used to be. Anyhow, with that, we will be back momentarily. You're listening to the Frontiers of Freedom Hour of Action. I'm George Landreth with my good friend and co-host Rick Trader. We will be right back in just a few minutes.
Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We're establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired as I am about the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. on WNJC Radio 1360 AM or around
around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our websites, ConservativeCommandosRadioNetwork.com and CCRN.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Biden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
Welcome back, friends. This is George Landreth and Rick Trader with the Frontiers of Freedom Hour of Action. We are coming to you live, and we were just talking about some of the doomsayers, and we were trying to work a little Yogi Berra into that. I just thought, you know, if we were going to cover one of Donald Trump's press conferences or one of his, you know, political speeches, you know what we could say about that, borrowing from Yogi Berra's? Nobody goes to see Donald Trump anymore. It's way too crowded. things like that, right? It's just way too crowded. Nobody goes there, right? Well, anyhow, now let's get back into something serious here. The New York Times is reporting on President Barack Obama's meeting with Putin and how Russia's going to take the lead on fighting against ISIS. And it just, you know, they met yesterday in New York at the UN, and their agenda supposedly was, you know, we said we wanted to talk about, you know, Syria and ISIS and Ukraine, and they said more they want to talk about Syria and ISIS. So I think that means they don't want to talk about Ukraine. I don't know. That's how I do math, though. Mm-hmm. But at any rate, I don't know how that meeting went. You know, it was, they came out and kind of said hi quickly and then walked off stage. It wasn't really any, no announcements, no, they didn't even say they'd had, like, frank discussions, which usually means we disagreed on everything, but we just thought we'd say something. And so, you know, it just struck me as kind of, what was that all about, and what has happened? And on one level, can't be too critical of the president in that instance, because I didn't think much was going to come of this, but I think the real criticism of the president isn't whether or not yesterday's meeting went well. It's the last 7 years that led up to why yesterday's meeting didn't go well. For 7 years, we've done all the wrong things, and that's what happens. But when I saw them, I thought again of Yogi. He once said it was impossible to get a conversation going because everyone was talking too much. And so maybe that was the problem: is that the president and President Putin just couldn't get anything talking because everyone was talking so much. I don't know, but at any rate, interesting news though out of that is. On some level, it probably sounds good to have Russia fighting ISIS rather than us, you know, and so forth. But the problem is when we retreat like that, Russia fills the void, and there are real costs to that. And it's not just a function of that they get to fight ISIS, and, quote, we don't have to. It's about what happens in the region. And the Russians historically have had a very strong policy. Mm-hmm. They would cultivate close ties with authoritarian regimes in the Middle East. And they rarely missed an opportunity to do that. And then when they did that, of course, they always worked against our interests. Over time, that didn't work out well for them. And over time, most of the Middle East rejected them and kind of came more in our orbit. And when I've traveled in the Middle East, I always found it interesting for them to describe how that happened and why that happened. And their belief that America provided strong leadership. And over the last 7 years, we've taken that away. And so their interest in being in our orbit is much smaller. So to me, it's not just about who's going to fight ISIS. It's about whether or not we're going to have the influence in the world to protect our interests and to have people that are friends that will help us protect those interests. And when we look weak, that's not how it works. I think you've described kind of they just follow the strongest, you know, the strongest.
They follow the strongest tribe.
Yeah, the strongest tribe. And so,
right now, the strongest tribe in
Syria. To me, that's what I saw yesterday was I saw we looked weak. We looked like a weak tribe, and it's not surprising when you hear the news about how our allies are becoming former allies now, and they're out looking for other options.
You know, George, what my thought is about this is if you have Russia in fighting ISIS, the ISIS rebels will leave Syria and go into surrounding countries. That is spreading the war. So what is Russia then going to do? Chase ISIS down into the neighboring countries of Syria? And also, as far as you were saying, with the Russians making themselves stronger and more prestigious in the area, this is exactly what we had in the 1960s and in the 1970s when there was a huge Russian-Soviet influence in the Middle East. It was Ronald Reagan who combated that, who stopped that. It was Israel who stopped that, who fought, who combated that, who defeated it. And here we go again, George. Deja vu all over again. You have Russia again inserting itself into the Middle East.
Well, yeah, and their influence is growing, and ours is shrinking. And I just remember talking with a successful businessman and a person kind of import in the Middle East, and he was explaining kind of why these countries had come into America's orbit and left the Soviet Union's orbit. And it wasn't just because of Soviet Union culture. They were leaving that orbit before then. Mm-hmm. And the reason was simply the one that you described, is they wanted to be, it was clear to them that that America was the better mm-hmm. choice. Mm-hmm. It was the stronger tribe.
Yes.
And it had the added benefit, they said, of we were less difficult. In other words, when you invited the Russians in mm-hmm. to be your, you know, to help you, they always wanted to be in charge of everything, and they felt like you were the servant and they were the master. And he acknowledged freely that we were much more inclined to treat you like you were a partner. And mm-hmm. and while maybe the U.S. was the majority partner or the senior partner, the reality was you were not treated as if you were, some sort of second-class citizen and just treated shabbily. And so they kind of liked both things. They said, you know, we have the stronger tribe, and we have a tribe that actually treats us better. That's a win-win. And he kind of described this, and we're losing that influence, and that has real costs. It's not just a theoretical cost. Mm-hmm. For those who think only in terms of money, it actually has money costs. For example, if you're an American ally, you tend to want to work with Americans, and therefore you want to buy American products. Some of them are military products, and some of them are non-military products. They're just average, everyday things that mm-hmm. Americans produce. But that's what your orbit is. When you leave that orbit, mm-hmm. then American products are not quite as important, and certainly American military products are no longer important to you because you're now trying to cooperate with and do joint exercises with a different country and a different orbit. And so all of a sudden, you know, you don't necessarily need to be buying, F-16s or anything like that. That has a real cost to us as well, both from a national security perspective and an economic perspective, because Americans are making those products.
George, I have to ask you a question. Let's play out the string here. Okay. So Russia right now is in Syria backing the Assad regime. Makes me think about what the Russians went through in Afghanistan during the 1980s. Number one, and I'll ask two or three different part questions. Do you think Russia learned anything through its escapade into Afghanistan that turned out to be disastrous? Number two, it was U.S. aid to the Mujahideen that led to the defeat of the Soviet Union in of the time. And then there was the vacuum that was created when Russia left, which led to the Taliban, which led to 9/11, which led to us being in Afghanistan today. So another part of that question is, playing out this string with the Russian involvement in Syria right now, does the United States now partner with ISIS? Does the United States now start to supply ISIS defeat to fight Russia, to fight the Assad regime? Does Russia pull out of Syria in a few years, leaving another power, leaving a vacuum there? And lo and behold, we have the same type of problem in Syria that we had in Afghanistan.
Well, those are, I mean, I think that there's many lessons we learn from history. My experience is that Russians are relatively, you know, their leaders are smart. They're not stupid. They are ideologically skewed, and they obviously are power hungry. Russia has historically, they've never really had a true democracy. They've always had autocrats of some sort, so, you know, running the country. Some achieve their power through birth, like the czars. Others achieved it through, you know, political maneuvering, like Lenin and Stalin and so forth. But the reality is these were all autocrats that ran the country on their own. They're certainly not committed to democracy. So, I mean, I think that creates a problem, because when your whole focus is on kind of maintaining a grip on power, it skews the decisions you make. But having said that, I don't think they're stupid. I think they're wrong, and they certainly make mistakes. And I suspect that the Syria will end up being a mistake, but I hope it's not because we end up siding with ISIS. I mean, I think this will be a mistake without our trying to aid ISIS in any way. Ultimately, I believe that if you look at policy from doing what is the right thing, it generally leads to good outcomes. It takes a while. So, you know, sometimes politicians are impatient, and so they want to rush things, and they're interested in taking shortcuts, and they don't want to do the right thing. They just want to do what they think will suit them politically today in the 24-hour news cycle. One of, I think, Ronald Reagan's pieces of wisdom was he understood that in the long run, good policy is also good politics. And so I think, you know, America needs to focus on doing the right thing, and it will redound to our benefit. And I can't believe that helping ISIS is the right thing.
I can't believe it either, but you see this scenario I'm playing out here.
Oh, no, I don't think the scenario you're playing out is implausible. And on many respects, I expected this to backfire in Russia, but that's what I think, one of the things where I think Putin is probably blinded somewhat by his desire to invigorate, if you will, or to reconstitute the former Soviet empire, at least in part. He may not get it all, but he wants to. He's, you know, doing that in Ukraine and Crimea and so forth. And yeah, you can see him wanting this in the Middle East. He sees this as a real opportunity, which again brings me back to this whole point of weakness is provocative. And when you behave weakly, you provoke people like Putin, who I believe is not a good man. He's evil. He's a dictator. Mm-hmm. You give him an opportunity. You give him an entree. You give him an opening. And that's what you don't do. You do not encourage the bad guys. And I believe that ISIS has been encouraged by our weakness, and I would argue that so has Putin. And this is an example of why you need a strong president. That doesn't mean you have to be in war all the time. That's the other false choice that Obama always gives, is you either do what I want to do, or you obviously want to be in perpetual war. And I just say, step back from that and say, that's not what I've been suggesting. I think you're making war more likely, not less likely. Mm-hmm. Ronald Reagan defeated Soviet communism, and he never fired a shot. So you don't have to go to war to win big victories. But it's time for a break, and so we are going to come right back. We've got lots more to talk about, many interesting things in the news. This is the Frontiers of Freedom Hour of Action. We'll be back in just a few minutes, so don't go away.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We're establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired as about the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. on WNJC Radio 1360 AM or around the world on the Internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our websites, conservativecommandosradionetwork.com and ccrn.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. If this is ink on paper, we must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Biden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
Greetings, fellow Americans. I'm George Landreth, and this is the Frontiers of Freedom Hour of Action. We're back. I'm here, of course, with my friend and co-host, Rick Trader, and we are coming to you live from WNJC 1360 AM in Philadelphia, and, of course, worldwide on Al Gore's amazing internet. Rick, are you able to hear me?
Yeah, I hear you, George.
Okay, good, because I wasn't getting the same feedback I usually do, and I was worried that maybe I dropped off or you had or something. So,
nope, you're all...
Who knows? Maybe it was that climate change.
I hear you, and hopefully America hears you, too.
Well, I thought there was something very interesting. There's this story in the last week or so about Ahmed Mohammed. He's the kid down in Texas who built or invented a clock. It looked a lot like a bomb, and it got him in a little bit of trouble. And then later the story kind of, you had the president tweeting, and you had other people talking about what a great mind he was, and that was a shame that we were so anti-Muslim, that simply when he's inventing and building these cool devices that everyone assumes that something like this is a bomb. But it's interesting how when the facts catch up with the headlines, you learn something a little bit different.
And what might that be, George?
Well, an engineer reverse engineered, if you will, Ahmed's clock, and he concluded that it was a hoax. He said all he did was buy a clock at the store, just an alarm clock. What you could, you know, go to Walmart or Target or anywhere you want, and just buy yourself a $20, bedside digital alarm clock. And he took it out of its plastic casing, which would have taken a Phillips head screwdriver. And then he attached it inside of a pencil box with some, and had wires trailing out of it and so forth. He didn't invent anything. He took something out of a case, put it into a pencil box. That's it. And then he brings it to school claiming he wants to show his teacher because he's proud of what he's, quote, invented. Okay, well, I don't know about you, but he's in high school. Okay, you can ask my mom. I used to take away, she'd throw away an old clock. I'd take it out of the trash can and take it apart. I didn't take it to school with me, of course, but I wasn't inventing anything. I just thought it was kind of cool to take things apart and see what made them tick and how they worked and why they worked or why it didn't work because it was in the trash. But my point is that doesn't make me an inventor. And it never occurred to me that I would even take this to school and show people, hey, I'm proud of this. Look, I took apart my mom's alarm clock. Ooh, mm-hmm. I removed some screws. Aren't you impressed? I can remove screws. I have thumbs. Isn't that cool? But you guys don't can't do that. You know, it's like, anyhow, just kind of weird. But I guess then you look at his family history, and his dad's a little bit of a odd sort of self-promoting fellow as well. The Washington Post, again, something I don't normally rely on a lot, but here they talk about how he, in an article from 2011, they talked about how he was portrayed himself as a scholar, an Islamic cleric, or sheikh, and then they report that leaders in Texas said they'd know that, including the imam at the mosque where he worships. This is the quote from the Washington Post: "This so-called leader, we have never heard of this person." Unquote. And then "I believe the whole thing is being made up," was the final quote from this cleric down in Texas, referring to the father and his supposed expertise in Islamic law and so forth. So it just seems to me like father and son are cut from the same cloth, and they're out trying to kind of get in the news. And it looks to me like the son purposefully, when you read Mark Cuban's interview and stuff like that, purposefully created something provocative. He was told by a teacher earlier in the day, "By the way, that kind of looks like a bomb, so why don't you put it in your backpack?" "I know it's not, but just put it in your backpack so that it won't be a problem." Well, that was the teacher's take. He then, of course, brings it out in the next class and has it on the desk and is showing everyone. Mm-hmm. So this is somebody who was doing exactly what the teacher thought perhaps he was doing, which is trying to look provocative. Yeah. And then all of a sudden, the rest of America is guilty of some sort of prejudice or whatever it is, because they're told, if you see something, say something. And he was trying to look like they saw something. He was an attempt to get attention by making something that looked dangerously and suspiciously like a bomb, but of course was not a bomb, so he could later claim innocence and then claim that they were, you know, bad people or something. That's what it seems like to me. And I don't know. Do you have any reaction to this story? But it kind of annoys me that getting free computer stuff from companies. They're acting like he's some big celebrity.
Yeah, George.
He's a stupid little punk.
Yeah. George, I, like you, took stuff apart when I was a kid. Very seldom did I ever get them back together, though. So I got to hand him that. But it's like father, like son. They're both cheaters. They're both...
Well, for the record, he didn't actually put it back together. He just took it apart and stuck it in another box.
No, he cheated. He cheated. When I think of science experiments, boys doing science experiments, I think of Homer Hickam and Rocket Boys, how they developed their own rocket, you know, from scratch. That's what I think of as ingenuity. And then this
that's
kid
what a,
gets...
That's what a real high school inventor does.
Exactly. And then this kid gets tweeted to by the president, cool clock, okay? But, you know, there's a lot of other amazing things the kids do today. I'm not sure, George, if you had an opportunity to watch the Pope's visit to Philadelphia. Saturday night, there was a young boy, Bobby Hill, 14 years old, who's a member of the Keystone State Boys Choir. They needed someone to fill some time. And they asked the choir director of the Keystone Boys State Boys Choir, "Do you have anybody who can do anything?" With 5 minutes' notice, this young boy gets up on the stage and sings "Pai Jesus" beautifully, beautifully.
Oh, yeah, I heard it. It was
That's
amazing.
The type
acapella,
of young man.
It was his first time ever singing a cappella.
That's
and it was fabulous.
It was fabulous.
No, I totally agree. I mean, I work with a scout troop. The youth are doing amazingly wonderful, selfless, smart, intelligent things all the time.
Yes.
And this Yahoo makes the news and gets, they send some computer company, I think it was Microsoft, or somebody sent him a bunch of stuff, you know, like, "Oh, that's wonderful what you're doing. We feel so bad that you're mistreated." And it's just, you know, on some level, the president needs to, he's willing to step in on all kinds of stupid stuff. It's interesting the selective stuff he steps into. But, you know, he doesn't step into other things, you know, an illegal alien shoots somebody, dead, and he doesn't make a statement about it. But every time something else happens, he wants to tweet that cool clock, or the police acted stupidly, or whatever it is. I find it very revealing what this president thinks he should be tweeting about. And it shows to me a really, really, I think, almost perverse view of America. because, you know, what he wants to see is he wants to see the police in a bad light. He wants to see Americans as prejudiced, who dislike people and so forth. And yet that's not what's actually there, but that's what he wants to see, so that's what he does see. And I find that really appalling. I liked it better when the president, like President Reagan, talked about when they, people said, you know, he said, people tell me there are no more heroes. And I just say that they're looking in the wrong places. There's heroes all around you. And then he talked about how some are behind lunch counters and some of them are on the other side of the counter. And they're just everywhere. You know, that America is littered with heroes. And if you understand what you're looking for, you'll think that's a huge difference. And I wish we had a president who felt that way. Well, speaking of other news, I know we're going to be coming up on a break in just a couple minutes. So we should probably shift gears and touch on this never-ending Clinton email saga. It turns out that she not only sent emails, we already know she sent classified emails, even though she's claimed she didn't. Now it turns out that her chief of staff sent classified information to the Clinton Foundation, to people that worked there. And so it just kind of, you know, the more you stir this, the more it stinks kind of a story. But interestingly, it was marked confidential. But just so everyone understands, it doesn't actually matter. As a former director of the U.S. Information Security Oversight Office has explained, he said, this was a J. William Leonard. He said, foreign government information is, quote, born classified. And all he really means by that is if you are in a room and you hear certain kinds of things being discussed, no one has to tell you that they are classified. For example, if the when the president is sitting down talking with advisors about an operation to go get and kill bin Laden, no one in the room has to say, oh, and by the way, this is all top secret, you know. Everyone in the room knows that. It goes without saying. That's the, when you have that kind of job, that's part of the job, is that you know that these things. You're not some stupid idiot who has to say, oh, by the way, this is all between us. Everyone knows that, and yet she's acting as if somehow, like, oh, how was I to know? Nobody told me, you know. And that's the thing that's crazy. But what's interesting is every time the story takes another gyration, what we find out is the story she told us last week wasn't true. And, you know, another story, another lie, another story, another lie. At some point, you kind of wonder, when is she going to decide that, you know, honesty is the best policy? This story drives me nuts, but maybe I'm just overreacting. How do you see it?
Well, George, the story also drives me nuts, and I want to know where the media is on all this. Where is the mainstream media? Why aren't they? If Hillary Clinton was a Republican presidential candidate or somebody who was running for the nominee on the side, they would be all over this like white on rice. But they're not. They're ignoring this story. Instead, they're focusing on what Donald Trump is saying, or how Carly Farina is responding to Donald Trump, or what the media is saying, they themselves, the media, is saying about Donald Trump. Where is the media? Where is the media in searching this out, and searching out the
right.
truth?
They're much more trying to cover differences, you know, like disagreements that come up between the Republican nominees, than the fact that statements that Hillary gave last week are now being contradicted by the statements of both Hillary Clinton now and the State Department. That's not interesting. I'd rather discuss about, you know, so-and-so, you know.
George, you know, last week on Frontiers of Freedom, Hour of Action, we were discussing the debate. And I recall in our conversation last week, you were talking about the questions that was asked. And one of the questions was asked, what would you want your code name to be? Remember that, George?
Right.
Remember that? So this is what the media wants to focus on. These silly gotcha things to trip up a Republican, but they are doing nothing to demand the truth about the emails. They're doing nothing to demand the truth about Benghazi.
Well, it's frustrating because they'll sometimes, you know, criticize somebody, a candidate. It can be anybody. It could be, you know, whether it's Trump or whether it's Rubio. Oh, we don't think he's being substantive enough. Well, I'll give you an example. You ask a guy a question like, what would you like your code name to be? It's hard to sound really substantive there. Right? What's the policy position here? You know, yesterday, Donald Trump released a pretty detailed tax plan.
Yes, he did.
And by all accounts, it's a pretty good tax plan.
Parts of it I don't like.
Yeah, I'm kind of the same boat. There's a lot of it I like. I think it'll help create jobs. And there's a few things I'm not sure I like that much. But the reality is, it would be a huge improvement we have now. But it's substantive. And yet, that's, you know, what they want to talk about is other stuff. They do not want to talk about substance, particularly when it comes to the Republicans. And this is, there's just not a lot of honest purveyors out there. In fact, I will have to give Ron Fournier a shout-out, because he actually has a headline just the other day in National Journal in which he says, Hillary, come clean or get out. Mm-hmm. And he's, you know, he's made it pretty clear. He's tired of, you know, he's willing to cover it. But I would say you're exactly right. Most of the mainstream media looks at this, you know, Fox News will cover it. You'll get the mainstream media covering Bill Clinton, denying that it's a story and that nobody should be covering it. But there's very little, you know, you watch ABC, CBS, NBC News, MSNBC, CNN. You don't get a lot of coverage on Hillary Clinton's email, and it's an absolute scandal. And it's crazy.
Indeed it is. Hey, George, you know what? I'm looking at the clock, and we're past break. You want to take us to it?
I think we should. We will be back in just a few minutes for our final segment of the Frontiers of Freedom Hour of Action. So stay tuned. Don't go away. We promise we'll end with a bang, and you'll have a lot of fun, and hopefully learn a lot, too. See you in a moment.
Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We're establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired as I am about the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. on WNJC Radio 1360 AM or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our websites, ConservativeCommandosRadioNetwork.com and CCRN.com for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vide, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last, liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vide of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
With the final segment of the Frontiers of Freedom Hour of Action, this is George Landreth with my co-host Rick Trader, and we're coming to you live on WNJC Radio, 1360 in your AM dial in Philadelphia, and of course around the world on the internet through many means, but one of them, and perhaps the easiest, is WNJCRadio.com. You know, we've been discussing a bunch of different things. I thought I might just quickly throw this one out there, and then we can get to this whole, what I would call, why scandals matter. It's not. Sometimes people think they're just interesting and juicy, and that's why they're covered. But if somebody who cares about the rule of law, I kind of want to explain why a scandal really is eats at the heart of a nation. But I thought it was interesting. Karl Marx apparently is back in fashion. That's a quote, back in fashion, if you're to believe Britain's Labour Party. John Macdonald, he's a former trade unionist, and he's a member of the Labour Party, and apparently will be the finance minister if the Labour Party becomes, you know, makes it back into power. And he's said that Marx has come back into fashion, and all I can think of there is... One, fallacies do not cease to be fallacies because they become fashions. That's a quote from G.K. Chesterton. Mm-hmm. But it seems to me this teaches a couple different things. One is, for the hard left, there simply is nothing. There's not a falsehood. There's not a fabrication. There's no deceit that is simply too crazy, too absurd, too easily proven false, too mendacious to be accepted, embraced, advocated, and trumpeted as if it were the truth. And it also seems to me that we have to be prepared to recognize that no political victory is permanent, which highlights the reason for a show like this and for the work that you do at Conservative Commandos, what I do at Frontiers of Freedom, is because we must always be prepared to fight, and we have to be prepared to combat falsehood and these sort of dangerous things by being vigilant. And it's always an effort, and we have to always do it. I don't know if you have any comments on that, but that was, I thought it was an interesting piece of news that there's someone stupid enough to tell us that Karl Marx is back in fashion.
Why?
Yeah.
Why?
It happened in the last year or two that would suggest that the only thing wrong with the world is we need a little more Karl Marx. You know?
George, I think...
Good heavens. What stupid university live in to believe that?
I think if there should be anything to learn from American exceptionalism... It should be that capitalism works and communism doesn't. When the Soviet Union collapsed, when the Soviet bloc of Eastern Europe collapsed back in the late 1980s, early 1990s, my God, how much more proof do you need? And these people that try to take us into a direction of socialism, capitalism in this country, every move they make fails. Like, look at the cylinders that come out of the socialism of this administration, or this administration trying to socialize. Oh, we can take government money and prop up industries that are doomed to fail in the begin with.
Right.
You know,
well, I mean, that's a good transition into the whole concept of scandal, because one of those scandals is Solyndra, not just because they funded something that didn't work, because government does that a lot, and it can be done sometimes in good faith.
Mm-hmm.
But Solyndra wasn't done in good faith.
No.
The filings that were made on their face made it clear that they did not qualify for any government loans. And yet they were given over $500 million in government loans. And one has to ask why. The Inspector General, of course, has his questions about that, because he said that on the face, their application made it clear they didn't qualify, they didn't deserve it, they were going to lose money, it was obvious they were going to go out of business, and yet they were given over $550 million. And if you've ever seen the video of going through their offices, those are some mighty nice offices. Middle managers who had showers in their offices, things like that. Showers that had television set in the shower.
What?
That's what... I'm not kidding! When someone gives you $550, you can build a really, really nice office.
Oh, my God. You know, George, I thought I was doing pretty well. Then I had a little radio in the bathroom.
Yeah. No. We're talking big screen TVs in your bathroom. In the office. All at taxpayer expense. So anyhow, the reason why these scandals matter is because the rule of law dictates that we must all obey the law and that no one is above the law. But scandals often involve the abuse of power. And sometimes it's for personal gain. Other times it's the abuse of power occurs because it's an attempt to just keep a grip on power.
Yes.
And, of course, sometimes that abuse of power is simply to get at and harm your adversaries in the political system. And we've seen all of that occur. some of Hillary's scandals, I think, have to do with personal gain things. I think part of the, I suspect we'll find out what drove some of the secrecy on email is that she was directing money to the Clinton Foundation and to, essentially into her pockets through some of her decision-making and promises being made, and she didn't want that record kept. I think some of the abuse of power we've seen is to maintain a grip on power, and you've seen that with some of the IRS stuff, and you've seen that with the State Department scandals. You've seen that, I think, also in the whole some of the Department of Justice scandals. So I think it may make sense to go through some of these, explain. But the reason why this is so corrosive is we often think of scandals as, oh, somebody in the government gave someone some money they didn't deserve, and that's dishonest, and that's bad. And of course, that's bad. And you know, but it's not just bad. It really does. The most harmful thing about a scandal is particularly scandals that go defended and unpunished, is that the scandals and abuses essentially rob Americans and the American society of whatever faith they have in their government and in the broader society. And government, a government that's designed to be a free people, it has to have credibility. You can't have a system where everything's based entirely on enforcement, where everything is required. You know, people pay taxes, not because they're made to, but just because, I mean, they understand that there's an implied threat there. I understand that. But there's no way the IRS can audit all of us. And so it requires us to essentially have a lot of people who just agree to participate. The same thing with our criminal laws. There's not enough policemen to protect every house. I mean, you know, you have multiple doors on every house. Are we going to have guards at every one of those to keep people out? The reality is society works because most people obey the law and abide by the rules. And the police are there to deal with the few that don't. But when society demonstrates that even the government is corrupt and broken, it kills off any incentive that the law-abiding people have to continue to abide by the rules. And eventually society breaks down. And that's why you see some of these other countries where corruption is so rampant. Their societies are broken. And it's because the government led the way through its own corruption. So to me, that's the real damage. It's not the $500 million that some stupid idiot got to waste on office space and stuff that wasn't really theirs coming. It's that they're corroding America itself and damaging America itself. And so you look at whether it's the IRS scandal of targeting or the selective audits, the lost emails, or the phony emails addresses used by, you know, Toby Miles, so they could avoid detection of what they were doing. Mm-hmm. All of this stuff, you know, whether it's the IRS that doesn't listen to a federal judge telling them what to do, whether it's Solyndra that we've already talked about, whether it's the State Department with its email scandals and Hillary Clinton, or whether it's you know, the EPA and its email scandal, you know, Richard Windsor, mm-hmm. Phony name. You know, whether it's the Pentagon, who is now investigating CENTCOM, and whether or not they were painting rosy pictures to meet Barack Obama's expectations and his talking points. It goes down the line. The EPA and the Animas River, the scandal there. The lies and the cover-up about China and Russia hacking into the United States personnel files. This list goes on and on. I mean, I've got two more pages of this stuff I could just rattle off to you. But the problem there is these things corrode America's foundation of liberty and freedom, and that's why they really matter. And so because these things matter, I hope Americans will make sure that they stand up to it and say, enough's enough, we're not going to put up with it. But with that, I guess our time is up. We have to probably wind up, do we not?
We do, but George, you're going to be holding over for us. We're going to be starting the Conservative Commandos radio show in just a few minutes, and you're going to be staying with us, correct, George?
I am.
All right. And with that, George, I'll let you wrap up this segment.
Sounds good. Well, I just want to thank you, Rick. I want to thank our listeners. It's been great to be with you today. And I just want to remind everyone, the price of freedom is eternal vigilance. So keep on keeping on. Freedom is worth defending. Don't forget to visit our website at www.org. This is George Landreth with my co-host Rick Trader signing off. Let freedom ring.
The leader in talk radio on the internet, right here on K98 Talk, www.thewescoast.com.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break. And they will break, and at the worst possible time. Call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-513-6154. That's 1-800-513-6154. Again, 1-800-513-6154. Call now.
This is Slickery Trigger for Rebel Road Tactical. With proper care and feeding, your pistol will be ready when you need it, there to save your life. Shouldn't your gear be that good? Whether you need a holster for comfortable everyday carry or a tough-as-nails holster for your next training course, Rebel Road Tactical has what you need. Check us out on the web at rebelroadtactical.com.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.